afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are delighted to welcome Mr. Robert Wilson here to the BRAFA. He is invited by the gallery Jean Bernier and Marina Eliade, who are present here at the BRAFA. He is presenting at the gallery two major videos, one on a deer and another one on other animals, and some drawings. But before we go into that work that he's presenting here, I would like to introduce him very briefly. For as much as that might be necessary, very, very briefly on what Mr. Wilson, Robert Wilson has done. So he is a foremost American theater stage maker, theater stage director. He has directed for over 45 years, especially in West Europe, but also, of course, in USA. He became very well known overnight in 1976 when he threw Einstein on the beach at the Festival of Avignon. And that was a revolutionary opera. The music was by Philip Glass. The choreography was by Lucinda Childs. And it was Mr. Wilson who conceived and drew the skeleton of the opera without a plot. But that opera, 1976, Avignon, and then many, many Western European capitals, became a revolution. It revolutionized the genre of opera, and opera at that time, 1976, was about death, if not, well, completely dead. And there suddenly this was a boost. It rejuvenated the opera ever since. Ever since then also Mr. Wilson has staged many, many plays, classic operas by Verdi, Puccini, Monteverdi, Brecht, Shakespeare, Euripides, etc., etc., the classics, all over. And each time he pushes the boundaries of the theater. But aside from being a theater stage director, he's also a plastic artist. And he makes drawings, he makes sculptures, he makes fantastic VOOM, high definition video portraits. And he makes also sculptural installations. He exhibited at the Venice Biennale in 1993, where he got the Golden Lion for the best sculptural installation ever done. Since he has exhibited at the Centre Pompidou, at the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam, at the Guggenheim New York, Guggenheim Bilbao, etc., etc. It seems like everything that Mr. Wilson is touching upon turns into gold. So I would like to ask Mr. Wilson, could you tell us more about how you came to conceive to make these VOOM, high definition, video portraits on animals, and especially the one here present on the deer, the Rocky Mountains elk?
Since the very beginning of my career in the theater, I've been fascinated with stillness and the movement that is in stillness. So the earliest works from the late 60s in the theater were very much about the movement in stillness. And I think part of it came from, as a boy, looking at animals. I used to have to go hunting with my father in Texas, where I grew up, and we would go deer hunting with my father and his friends. And I didn't want to have a gun, I didn't want to shoot a deer, but I would go hunting with my father and his friends. And the nicest thing about it is you'd get up early in the morning and you could go into the forest or the woods and hide. And I could stay all day alone. And so as a boy, I at times would see a deer. And what was amazing is, long as I was still, they were still. Kleist, the German author, said, a good actor is like a bear. He will never move first. He'll wait for you to move. So I think this, coming from my childhood, has been a a thread through all of my work, whether it was staging an opera. I just staged The Messiah in Salzburg, Mozart's Messiah. And the singers on stage, whether it's the chorus or principal singers, often are dealing with stillness. For me, in the theater, opera, it's too busy. It's too much going on, it's too distracting. And if I really want to hear music, it's better to close my eyes. And then I listen more carefully. So the challenge as a director for the stage, can I create something on stage that helps me hear better than when my eyes are closed? So I think that the portrait I have here of this Rocky Mountain elk goes way back to my childhood. It's the movement in stillness. And,
was it very tough to make that portrait with the deer? Because it looks so still, for 7 minutes it does not move. Starting from the ears, blinking the eye, yeah.
Well, I think if the people who were observing filming, if we had been moving, he would have run away. So, but, I made a portrait once of a black panther, and the woman who owned him lived in California. She actually lived with this black panther. It was called Ivory. And so I had wanted the panther to recline on a table. And I said, do you think that Ivory would lie down on this table? And she said, yes, eventually I think he would. And so she put him on top of the table, and he was moving around, and finally he calmed down, and we had 38 technicians in the room, and I asked her, he had a silver chain around his neck, and she was holding the chain. I said, do you think we could take the chain away? And would Ivory stay on the table? And she said, I think so, I'm not sure. So we asked the technicians, would people be willing to stay in the room if we took the chain away? And so all but six said they would leave. So we had six technicians, we had a cameraman, and she said, it's best if I stand behind the camera, because I wanted the panther to look into the camera. And it was amazing. For 23 minutes, we took the chain off, and the panther stayed on the table. And no one in that room moved. But you know, it was amazing, those 23 minutes, the six of us who were in the room, for those 23 minutes, we were almost like the Black Panther. We were one, one entity. The way he was listening to us, and we were looking at him. And ideally, I've always thought that's what should happen on stage. where there's only one entity on stage, whether it's orchestra, whether it's technicians in the wing, performers on stage. If everyone is listening together, you have one entity. You can have different characters and different activities happening, but it's important that somehow we are one. And so that's been my fascination with animals.
May I come back one moment again on Einstein on the beach? In 1976, it was definitely an vanguard theater. You restaged it again in 2012, and it visited again many, many capitals. It went on a big tour. Do you regard that same work today as more classical?
It was always classical. It was maybe misunderstood then and even now, but all my works, for the most part, are classically constructed. Einstein on the Beach was an opera in four acts with three themes that reoccurred three times. Act one, theme A and B together. Act two, C and A together. Act three, B and C together. And act four, A, B, C together for the first time. This is a classical structure. It didn't tell a story, but it was theme and variation. So people were confused because they expected a story or an illustration of Einstein in a narrative way, but this was structured the way music is structured. So in 1972 or three, I made a 12-hour work and people said, oh, it's so avant-garde. Actually, the structure was a classical structure. Act one related to seven, two related to six, three related to five, and four was in the center. And it's where the piece turned, in the center of the fourth act. It's same as Shakespeare, King Lear. I shall go mad, says the king. It's the center line. The first half, he's in a man-made environment. And the second half, he's in nature. And it revolves around this center. Wagner's Parsifal is the center bar of the music, is the kiss of Kundry when Parsifal takes the lance of Klingsor. And he says, time becomes space. Parsifal is the white knight in the first half, and the last half he's the dark knight. The whole thing turns around the center bar of music. So most of my works have been developed around classical structures.
Yes, but what was new about this was that Einstein on the Beach did not have a plot.
No, it was a time-space construction and based on theme and variation.
Just quite abstract then.
Yes, and it was very curious with the Messiah, which I just opened a few days ago in Salzburg. It's completely abstract. So. It's all based on math and geometry. And people tend to want to stage it in a narrative way, but I feel that it's being imposed on something that is pure architectural sound. And Mozart made an opera that is classical in its form and its structure. And the beautiful thing about the work for me is that the surface is so simple, but beneath that surface you see it's very, very complex structuring of music.
Okay.
And it's completely abstract.
Yes.
I mean, the press is ridiculous because they're trying to, you know, they want me to tell a story of Jesus Christ. Christ is not even in the Messiah. It wasn't written, you know, but, you know, they want to see this guy, you know, with a cross.
Well, if we
and people do it. I don't.
Can we go back just one moment to the other works you're presenting at the gallery, Bernier Eliard, and those are drawings. A series of drawings in color and black and white, and they represent circles, totally abstract. Can you expand on that?
Very often I make preliminary sketches of structural sketches. And very often, those first sketches are what I think of as the bones of a work. So the body has skin, then it has meat, and it has bone. The surface is what makes the work accessible, and it's the longest and time. But beneath the surface, what makes the surface interesting is what's beneath it, and that is the meat. And then on an occasion, you know, you have this bone of the material, and that structure is very different. So I think abstractly, whether I'm doing King Lear of Shakespeare, if I'm doing Parsifal of Wagner, if I'm making Einstein on the beach, or these drawings that we're showing here were the first drawings of structural drawings of Einstein. Now, there are only two lines in the world, only two. There's a straight line and there's a curved line. That's all. So you have to make up your mind. Do I want 20 straight lines and one curved line? Or, I don't know, if you're Frank Gehry, you know, how many lines do you want? Make up your mind. sometimes I think he can't, but anyway. So the drawings for Einstein were these preliminary structural drawings that I look at as a kind of the bones of the piece. Working with straight lines, perpendicular, horizontal, diagonal, and curved lines, circular lines. These drawings were given to Philip Glass based on the structure I just outlined in four acts and three themes, A, B, C. And Philip wrote music from the drawings and from the structure. And Lucinda Childs made choreography based on these structural outlines. And some years after I did Einstein on the Beach, I had been asked to direct the Threepenny Opera in Berlin, at the Berliner Ensemble, where Bertolt Brecht worked, and he first presented Die Großen Oper in 1928. In that theater, and I was asked to direct a new production. And I started the same way. I started with lines, and they were more the structural bones of the work. So I don't see the drawings as illustrations of the play or the opera. To me, it's always makes me a little nervous if I see illustrations of theater. You know, most people who design for the theater make theater decoration. People go to school to study theater decoration. They should burn those schools. We don't need schools of theater decoration. Theater should be architectural. Should be structural. The Lord gave us eyes and he gave us ears, and what we see is as an important as what we hear, and it should not be a decoration. not a decoration for a play. See, with work like Einstein, we started with the drawings first, the look of the stage. And from that, music was written. Texts were added. We started with the visual book, which was movement, visual images. 5 times Washington, D.C. refused to copyright what I did as an author for Einstein on the Beach, because what I turned in was a book of drawings. And they say, this doesn't constitute a book for the opera. But it was. It was the book. And what we heard in the Philip Glass music in that opera was the numerical structure of the music. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, are the solfège. Do so, do so, do so fa, do re mi. So it was completely abstract what we were hearing. And then there were recitative parts that were spoken, texts written by Christopher Knowles, texts that were musically put together mathematically, but it was text of nonsense.
Since the 1980s, there is a new religion going on, which could be called contemporary art. Contemporary art is very, very popular. Masses of people go to major events, to great exhibits at the top museum. There's lots of high masses in Venice, in Kassel, in Basel, etc., etc. Is art, contemporary art, becoming the only narrative, collective narrative? Is it the only utopia that is left? Why is it so popular?
Well, art serves a unique function in society. It's unlike religion. It's unlike politics. Politics divide men. Religion will divide men. But art has the possibility to bring people together. Look at history. Let's go back 5,000 years from today. What do we look at? We look at artifacts. We look at what artists were making, creating. And if anything's around 5,000 years from today, it'll probably be artifacts, what artists are doing. Artists are the diaries and the records and the journals of our time. And so it has an important function in society. You can be in a theater sitting next to someone who has completely different ideas than yourself, you know, politically, socially, economically, but you can go to the theater and share something together. One of the few things that remains throughout time are the classics. The classic math and geometry. The mathematics of Mozart. You know, this work I just did is so modern, so contemporary, but it will last for years because it's classically constructed. George Balanchine, the choreographer, to me one of the most important artists of the 20th century, his works were classic construction, and he also made abstract ballets. But so the classics will always be around. Romantics, I think Frank Gehry will be interesting as a footnote, you know, 500 years from now. But I think Mies will be the one we look at, Mies van der Rohe.
Would you like to share with us your next project? What will you be working on tomorrow?
I'm going to go to my apartment in New York City, where I am never there. It's the only scheduled week all year that I can be in my own apartment. So that's what I'm doing next. I always liked what Gertrude Stein said. They said, "Oh, Miss Stein, what will you do next?" She said, "I think I'll have a glass of water." They said, "Oh, Miss Stein, what do you think of modern art?" She said, "I'd like to look at it."
No, but I meant, what is your next project?
No,
sorry, from having a glass of water. Yes. What is your next staging? Where? What about opera, theater, more plastic art?
What am I doing, Max? What am I doing? Huh? I'm doing Shakespeare's Tempest in Bulgaria. I'm going to do Oedipus Rex in Budapest. And I have an exhibition of glass in Venice, that pieces I'm working on. I think that's in May. I don't know. When I was 12 years old, in Texas, my mother was speaking on the phone to her friend. She said, "I don't know what Bob's doing, but he has a lot of projects."
Yes, we are at the beginning of a new decade, you know, 2020. Is there any message that you would like to give the audience?
A
message that you would, as an artist, visionary artist, would like to give to the audience about at the beginning of this new decade?
Well, I think what's very important for artists is to always say, what is it? What am I saying? What am I doing? And not to say what something is. So often I think that I feel uncomfortable in the theater because I think that the director, the actor, the designer, you know, they have this message. And so I feel like I'm in high school or something. Somebody's trying to teach me something. So I think it's important that we stay open and how all occasions do inform against me and spur my dull revenge. Examples gross as earth exhort me. Witness this army of such mass and charge, led by a delicate and tender prince, the nephew to old Norway. Fortinbras's divine ambition puffs, makes mouths at the invisible event. That's Shakespeare. That's Hamlet. I learned it when I was 12. And I'm 78, and I'm still saying it. And each time I say it, I can think about it in a completely different way. So to attach an interpretation to Shakespeare, a meaning, would negate the possibility of all the other ideas. So it's full of meanings. One of the most important things that happened to me when I was quite young, it was in the 60s, I met a man who was head of the Department of Psychology at Columbia University. And I had adopted a deaf boy who'd never been to school and knew no words. And it was curious as to how he thought. He thought in terms of visual signs and signals. He didn't know words. And the people that lived around him didn't understand that his problem was one of being deaf, not hearing. And I met Daniel Stern, who at that time was head of the Department of Psychology at Columbia University, and Dan was making, in 1967, films of mothers and babies. He was studying pre-verbal communication. between the mother and the baby. And he made over 250 films of mothers picking up babies in natural situations. A baby would cry, the mother would reach for the baby, pick up the baby, and comfort the baby. And Stern took 1 second of time and looked at it frame by frame. There are 24 frames in the film in 1 second. In 8 out of 10 cases, the initial reaction in the mother, in the first frame, the first 2 frames, no more than the first 3, is the mother is lunging at the child. And the child is, the next 2 or 3 frames, the mother is, and child is something else. Next 2 or 3 frames, the mother is something else. And the child's again something else. So that in 1 second of time, it's very complex what's going on. The mother, when she sees the film, broken down in 1 second, frame by frame, 24 frames, is shocked. She says, but I love my child. So perhaps the body is moving faster than we think. But there is a language there. So when Romeo says he loves Juliet, it's very complex. And that's why I find it always I'm troubled when I have an interpretation of, say, Shakespeare or anything, because the situation is so complex. And it's better to stay open and say, what is it, so we can reflect on it. Now, as a director or a performer or whatever, of course you have your own emotions, your own feelings, own ideas about what you're saying and what you're doing, but be aware that the situation is very complex. So my work in the theater is formal, so there's a certain distance for reflection. And I think what's important in theater, which I do, I guess, mostly theater, is to give time for people to think. It's very, very rare that we can trust that. And the situation now in theater, and it comes a lot from television, is that every 3 seconds, every 5 seconds, no more than 8 or 10 seconds, we have to understand the situation. Go to Broadway. Just listen to it. It's like television. You know, you have to understand how all occasions do inform against me and spur my dull revenge. Examples gross as earth exhort me. Witnesses are, it's in phrases, right? It's like every 3 or 4 words you have to understand. How all occasions do inform against me and spur my dull revenge. That's a line. So, it's full of meanings. And I was curious that I hear the public's reaction to the Mozart work I just did, or hear the reaction of the public to Einstein on the beach, how they and were implying interpretations. To me, Einstein's like listening to the birds.
Thank you for sharing all this. It's so important. So actually, you are an artist in time and in stillness.
In film?
Stillness. Time
and stillness, yes.
That is what you want to evoke in us when we see your work.
Martha Graham, the American choreographer, she said, there's no such thing as stillness. So sometimes when we're very still, we become much more aware of movement than when we make a lot of movement. But if we're aware of the stillness, of the movement in stillness, when you move outwardly, the line continues. So go to the theater tonight.
Hang on.
Okay, so this is what you will see. So you'll see the actor walk on stage and stop, right? Then you'll see him walk again and stop. No. If you're walking on stage and you stop walking, you're still moving. It's one line. There's no such thing as stillness. John Cage said there's no such thing as silence. There's always sound. But sometimes when we're very quiet, we become much more aware of sound than when we make a lot of sound. That sequence of sounds we just heard will never happen again. Never. So the only thing that is constant is change. So in the theater, especially, it's very important that in my work, that we listen to the silence. Because if you're listening to the silence and you begin to speak, the sound just continues. If the conductor is listening to the silence and he starts the music, the sound is just continues. It doesn't begin. So you can't begin anything, you can't end anything in the theater. It's one thing.
Thank you so much for this performance. I think the time is up for us for our talk, but now we invite you, audience, to ask some questions. We don't have much time left. We have about, 15 minutes? 15 minutes. So if you can ask your questions, preferably not speeches, but just clear and short questions. Mr. Wilson, I think, will be happy to answer them. Yes?
You're describing extraordinarily eloquently the paradox between every moment and how every moment becomes a continuing sequence and ultimately infinity. Why are you so drawn to that?
I'm fascinated by how every moment can be different, and why am I fascinated by that? Albert Einstein said, a critic or somebody asked him, said, oh, Mr. Einstein, can you repeat what you just said? He said, there's no need for me to repeat what I just said because it's all the same thought. Cézanne said he was always painting the same still life. And Proust said he was always writing the same novel. It's like a river. As long as you're living, it's flowing, it's one thing. It's a tree that's growing, and you know, it can be in a storm, and branches can be broken, but it's a young tree or an old tree, it's still the tree. So I can look back at my body of work, and it's one thing. It changes and very different, but it's one thing.
Another question?
If theater can be about one thing, which it should be, then it can be about a million things. But if it's not about one thing, it's too complicated.
Okay. Hi. I was fascinated by your description of your approach to directing theater as a kind of architecture. And I'm just wondering, when you direct more narrative works like Puccini, which you did last fall, does your approach change when there's a narrative structure that's not all
no.
architectural?
No, it's the same. I mean, if with a narrative, I mean, you're talking about Madame Butterfly, I guess, which I just performed in Paris at the opera. The difficulty with Puccini is that very often it's too sweet, it's too sentimental. And so, you need to find the bone in that, right? It needs a, ah! That's beneath it. So, stillness is slowness in theater is the most difficult thing to do. People say, oh, in Robert Wilson's theater, everyone moves slow, right? Well, if you think you're moving slow and you move slow, it's one thing. But if you don't think about it and you're moving slower than you normally would, everything is going. Every energy in the world, the body is full of batteries of different energies and it's constantly changing. So time has no concept. Time is something we experience. And as Susan Sontag said, to experience something is a way of thinking.
Next question.
Another question.
I read that you were also a collector. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I have a cultural center in Long Island, and I bring young people from all over the world, artists, and over 200 people a year come to the center. I don't want to have a school, so we're very different in our backgrounds and our aesthetic viewpoints. But I think what's important is a cultural center. I went to an art school, and there was no art. So if I wanted to see tribal art, I had to go to one institution. If I wanted to see classical painting or sculpture, I had to go to another. And so if I wanted to see modern art, and still have to go to another place. So the idea is that we as a cultural center live with awareness of what man's done in the past, a center that exists for creating works of our time. Andre Malraux said when he was the Minister of Culture, it's necessary for us to maintain a balance of interest and looking at what happened in the past. With a balance of interest and support for art of our time, creation. And on the other side, it's important that we maintain a balance of interest in protecting the art of our nation, of France, with a balance of interest in protecting art of all nations. So if we lose the awareness of what man has done in the past, which we understand through art, because it's one of the few things that remains. If we lose that awareness, we lose our memory.
We in Europe, we often give state money to artists to help them creating maybe art that is difficult to sell. What's your point of view? Do you think it influences in a good way or in a bad way? to support artists with?
You know, it's very curious. Art can happen in a country that is poor, a country that is oppressed. It can happen in a country that is affluent. It can happen in a country that is supported, where they support the arts. It can happen in a country where there's no support for the arts. It's in the nature of man. So the Watermill Center that I established in 1990, I don't get $1 of support from the United States government. So it's something I do on my own. But we are fortunate in that in getting support in the United States, that an individual can make a decision that I want to support this institution, and they have a tax advantage for doing so. So in a sense, the government does support the work, where here and in Europe, the government makes the decision. And that comes from the past, where the king said, you know, I'm going to commission this, and art happened that way. But I was a few years ago in Cuba. It was amazing to see what the artists are doing. You know? And I think it's also very important. One reason I have the center is that we live with awareness of what other cultures are doing. You know, what is happening in Afghanistan? What is happening in Bahia in the jungle in Brazil? What is happening in Mali? I was recently in Indonesia. You know, what's happening with the young kids in Java in video? I mean, it's astonishing. So art will happen regardless. And, but if we don't support it, we don't have it. So.
Especially in the performing arts, no? We need subsidies in the performing arts.
We need subsidies, and it's unnecessarily too expensive. I mean, I'm all for the workers' rights and workers being paid to work in the theater, but a stage technician at Carnegie Hall can make $575,000 a year. So this is more than a college president. It's more than a US senator. You know, to move, put a chair on the stage. So it becomes increasingly more difficult in my country with these unions. It's unaffordable. And you don't need all that money. And, you know, you don't need the Louis Vuitton, Frank Gehry museum there. You know, you can do it in a barn. And so we don't need to pay, you know, 280 million billion dollars, you know, for the shed we have in New York, which is impractical. I mean, it's.
Okay, there's a lady over there.
I have a question. It's more about performance art. What would you say that was the thing that you really remember from the work you did in performance art with Gaga and Marina Abramović? What really triggered you, or what do you remember most?
Well, Gaga is. I did a work for television with Lady Gaga, and I did video portraits, 30 or more video portraits of Lady Gaga. She's a brilliant musician. She plays Mozart on the piano, classical music. I staged her MTV award, and And 2 minutes and 22 seconds, she changed her clothes 7 times, shoes, makeup, hair, everything. But I made video portrait where she stood 11 hours in one position. Wow. And the people around her, from her, you know, she has to go to the toilet. I mean, you have to give her a break. She stood 11 hours, and she was not jumping around. So, wow. Meryl Streep could do that? Never. What actress do we know that can do that? So she understands stillness too, Gaga. What was Gaga and?
Abramovich.
Oh, Marina. Well, I've known Marina since the early 70s, and I was sort of in the same school as she was at that time, and but I changed, and so I went into a completely different direction, and I like things to be artificial. So for me to stand on stage is something artificial, it's not natural. And to sit on stage in a performance is not the way you sit on the street waiting for a bus. It's not the way you stand on a street corner waiting for a bus, because it's a stage. And the stage for me is unlike any other space. The light is different. The way you speak is different. The way you walk is different because it's a stage. So Marina, she was into, you know, being natural. And to me, when I see people on stage, you know, trying to act natural, it seems so artificial. And if you accept it as something artificial, I think you can be much more honest about what you're doing. Anyway, working with Marina, she had been asking me for years to do something with her, but finally I said, okay. And she asked me to design her funeral. So I said, okay, I'll stage it. I'll put it on stage. She said, oh, great, then I can see what it'll look like. So I went to 3 bodies buried. I want one buried in Yugoslavia, and Belgrade. I want one buried in Amsterdam, and I want one buried in New York. But no one will know who the real Marina is. So I said, okay, we'll stage it. So I started with her funeral, and with 3 bodies on stage. And Marina was one of them. The other two were dressed just like her. But no, it was difficult because I wondered, we designed a beautiful dress for her, a beautiful tissue. And I wanted her to sit on a block of ice, and I had made a plastic block of ice. I can't sit on a plastic. I want to sit on the real thing. I want to feel the cold ice, and I want to sit on the cold ice. No, I said, you'll get your dress all wet. So, but we got through it, and we're still good friends.
Mr. Wilson, we want to thank you so much for coming to Brussels, for coming to BRAFA, and for sharing all these so interesting insights and thoughts with us. And I must say, it is an absolute delight to listen to you, but even more so to look at you, to see you perform. So thank you so much for sharing
all this. Thank you.